the Sea of Galilee has always been known as a notorious sea. It's unpredictable. Out of the blue, a storm can arise and cause great havoc because of the geography. Some of you all may remember from your Bible studies, the sea, it's not a flat sea and flat land all around, but it's surrounded by hills and excuse me, gusts of wind can come down in just an instant and cause the sea to boil and great turmoil and danger. And I think that's probably what happened in our story today. They take off at night, and the next thing they know, they were in the midst of a storm. And you have to remember that the boat that they were in was a boat that may have been a little longer than the pew. Not much. It wasn't like the boats that we have, or at least the boat that I have today, which is a 21-foot Nautic Star with a 150 horsepower motor on it, and I can go out in the Gulf. Not the one that Jesus was in. And the other side that we're told they're going to is interesting because that was Gentile territory. That was dangerous territory. That was an area you didn't go to as a Jew. Yet in Mark, he makes sure we understand that. And this is a deliberate move of Jesus that his mission is going beyond the Jews. That's just a bit of trivia. By doing this, Jesus reaches out to the stranger, even the enemy of the Jews. If we were to speculate and maybe take this story on its, not just its literal sense, but in a allegoric or another level of meaning, this story raises for us the church, St. Luke's. We have to ask, who are the strangers, the foreigners, the others who are near us? Have we neglected them? Well, let's revisit the story again in a bit more detail. Let's break it down some phrase by phrase. The first thing we notice is that Jesus invites the disciples into the boat. Let us go across to the other side. That's Jesus speaking. The whole journey into the storm, out onto the sea in the dark, was Jesus' idea. What do you make of it? Evidently, discipleship is not always a matter of peaceful calm. You know, some of our greatest adventures with Jesus will be in the storm, in the dead of night, when it is dark, and when we are lost. And Jesus is in the boat with his disciples. They took him with them, just as he was in the boat. He journeys with them. They don't have to go it alone. He's with them all the way from the time they leave the boat until the time they get to the other side. He is always with them. And there's a storm, a great storm. A great storm of wind arose, and the waves beat into the boat, so that the boat was already filling. They didn't have a pump to get the water out like we do today. I have a bilge pump in my boat. I flip it on, and it sprays, throws the water out so I don't sink. They didn't have that. They were frightened. There is a storm, a great storm. Sailing with Jesus does not mean exemption from bad storms. We know that. In fact, Jesus, at least the storm implies, is one who invites us into, even leads us toward great storms because we are followers of Jesus. And Jesus is, he is unperturbed by the storm that so terrifies his disciples. Remember this little phrase. He was in the stern asleep on the cushion, and they woke him. He didn't bother to wake up because of the storm. He is serene. He's majestic. He's the Lord of the storm. But they don't understand that. What are you doing, man? And the disciples awake him and dare to ask a threatening question upon which hangs much of our faith in Jesus. Do you care if we perish, Jesus? Teacher, do you not care if we perish? Let's take this as the central question that evokes this text. Does Jesus care if we perish? Well, the answer, of course, is yes. Jesus does care if we perish. He arises and he stills the raging storm. He not only cares, but he also acts. He is the one who, when it is dark and all hope seems lost, rises, speaks, rebukes the wind and the waves, and saves those who, without his care and act, would be lost. So often we say to people, oh, we care about you, and we don't act. Jesus cares about them and acts. And takes action and does something. A model for us. And then Jesus wonders why his disciples are afraid, have no faith in him. Remember verse 40. He said to them, why are you afraid? Have you no faith? They had been with him a while. They'd seen what the wonderful things he had done. They still don't understand. This sort of misunderstanding and lack of faith is rather typical for the disciples in the Gospel of Mark. Yet, despite the misunderstanding, their lack of faith, Jesus does not desert those who have dared to travel with him. He keeps sailing with him. He does not seem to resent their misunderstanding or their failures. He is, thank God, not too choosy about his traveling companions. So look around the church to see who are Jesus' companions. So we know Jesus is not too choosy. He keeps saying to them and saving them, even while they fear that they might perish. And the story ends in wonder and awe and worship, in which his disciples are moved to ask, who is this? And the last verse, and they were filled with awe and said to one another, who then is this, that even the wind and the sea obey him? The answer to that question is not explicitly given. The answer to the question is not given to them. The story does not answer with, well, this is the Messiah. Well, this is the Son of God. No. Perhaps the answer is not given because it is an answer that can only be had as a gift, a byproduct of our time of wonder and awe, which we call worship. The answer to our deepest questions about Jesus, who is this? Is the gift of that vision and that experience given in the middle of the storm. read this story, I read it not only literally, but as a story of an event showing Jesus' power over nature. I also read it symbolically and see that other level that Jesus is trying to offer to the people. Here's what I mean. The first readers of the Gospel of Mark were probably people in Rome during the persecution of Nero. And they needed hope. They needed something to hang on to. This was a powerful story for them in the face of imprisonment, of punishment, of torture, and even death. In Jesus' presence, we can have peace, even in the wildest of storms of life. And I can only imagine that's what helped them get through those terrible times in the early, early days of the church. I believe Jesus gives us peace in the storms of life. For example, I know that Jesus gives us peace in the storms of sorrow. When sorrow comes to us, and it most certainly will and has, Jesus has promised us the glory to come. He changed the darkness of death into the glory of eternal life with his own light on that first Easter morn. Like many, many of you, I too have faced deep sorrow over the loss of a friend, a mother, a father, a wife, an aunt and uncle who were like my grandparents. I believe they were with the Lord. And a great peace came upon me. And most recently, I have been given peace in my sorrow over the loss of my wife of over 50 years. I have that deep, abiding belief that Pat is with her Lord, free of all her pain and her suffering. This belief helps me through my own feelings of loss and grief. And I have been deeply strengthened by the prayers, the cards, the comments, the calls of so many. Yes, Jesus does bring us peace in the storms of sorrow. And Jesus gives us peace when life's problems involve us in doubt or our uncertainty. I don't know about you all, but there have been lots of times in my life when I just don't know what to do. As a young person, as a young adult, and as a more mature adult, there are times when I don't know what to do. If we turn to Jesus and say to him very simply, what would you have me to do, Jesus? What do you want me to do? That seems simplistic. Well, I believe and I have experienced it. And the way will become clear to you and to me. Oh, by the way, it may not be what we think it ought to be. And it may not turn out to be the plan that we had devised. I think the truth really is, it is not that we do not know what to do. I think many times we know what to do, and we may not have the courage to do it. We just need Jesus to say, go ahead. And I do not mean this in a simplistic way, as I said earlier. No, this is hard, hard prayer work, wrestling with our conscience, looking for guidance in all the places that God puts before us, and looking at the facts and the situation, and then praying to God that you will make the right decision. Shared with the confirmation class when I was called to be rector of St. Paul's in Waco, I did not want to go. go, I knew that Jesus had made a mistake because I didn't want to live in Waco. You know, who would want to live in Waco? With all of those, well, no. So I made a deal, as I told the class. I said, okay, Lord, I'll be there for 5 years. And then I'll turn it over to someone else. I'll do what I can in 5 years. Well, after 18 years, I moved on. The Lord knew what to do, and I needed to yield to that decision, to accept that call. And it was not easy, and I didn't like it, and it was hard. But it was the right thing to do. Jesus is always with us. I want to close with just a brief little story. A photographer had taken this picture right after Hurricane Katrina in 2005 when it struck New Orleans. And this picture was of an old historic cemetery in New Orleans. In the middle of the devastation of the trees that were toppled over, the debris covering the ground, several burial vaults broken and smashed. But in the middle of the devastation, untouched by the storm, stood a statue of the risen Jesus Christ, arms extended wide, offering a benediction of calm amidst the chaos. Such is the image conveyed by this text that we heard this morning. The image of Christ with his arms extended wide over the chaos of our lives and our world, saying, peace, peace, be still.